Hello everyone. I'm going to start with a story. How many of you have experienced such experiences which feel very natural to you, but has totally changed in the last few years? Any example you have? Which is natural now, but it was not natural earlier. Is it audible? Okay, let me give you an example. The other day, I wanted to go home, so I wanted to take a taxi. I came down to my office and I saw there's a taxi waiting for me. And I thought, okay, let's just take this one, not book a cab today. And I took that taxi home. I reached home, I was very happy to see my kid. I started playing and pretty happy. But all of a sudden, I realized after some time, I forgot to pay the taxi driver. And it's like even the taxi driver didn't ask for it. I was so surprised. It happened because I was so used to taking cabs using these apps like Grab or Uber. We don't think about payment anymore. Like, we go to the we take a taxi, get out of it, and you're done, right? And we don't want to even fiddle with cash and spend that extra minute in the taxi. I want to get out of it as soon as possible. And this is a story I'm going to talk today, how things are getting invisible for us. I'm Mitushi. I work at Visa Innovation Center. We think about payments all the time. I am a passionate traveler. I'm a curious traveler, which makes me more passionate about different cultures. And to capture those different cultures and observation, I love photography. And yeah, I have a 2-year-old son, which makes me more empathetic now, I think, as a designer. And yeah, life is changing. Today I'm going to talk about three key things. The first is, invisibility is happening now. It was once a fiction, but it's no more a fiction. We are experiencing it in today's world. And how it is possible now, like what is enabling it? And the third thing, how can we design for it as designers? Invisibility is not a new thing. In 1911, Mark Weiser from Xerox PARC talked about ubiquitous computing. I'm sure many of you have heard about it. He was talking about how technology can get so pervasive that the things happening with that technology gets more natural to the user. He was talking about it's getting weaved into the user's life so much that we don't think about it. The experiences to us feel more natural. So yeah, he's been talking about it since 1911, but there are many other people who are talking about it. The fictional things. We have seen Black Mirror or Humans from Amazon, where we are seeing some live examples of how technology is enabling invisible experiences for us. It does get overwhelming a lot of times. And I'm not talking about Black Mirror, but I'm talking about real experiences, which is possible now. Getting coffee, very common scenario, right? We get coffee every day in the morning. Every day, we stand in the queue and order that coffee. Same coffee, but still have to stand in the queue, and still I have to make the payment and wait for my order. Why can't it happen more seamlessly? You know me, who I am. We can use beacons to identify who you are, establish the identity. Recommend me something which you know I would order most of the time, recognizing my pattern. I say, yes, why not? Just order that flat white. And tells me when the order is ready, and I just go to the counter and pick it up. And the payment here again is invisible. Like, it just happens, right? Like, I really don't need to take out that piece of plastic or take out my cash to make the payment. It can happen seamlessly. So here, the whole experience of getting coffee is still there, but how it's getting enabled is very invisible. Another example, thanks Ika for the connected car. I'm going to use that similar example here, but more for payment. So how can I pay for parking in much more seamless manner? Like, do you remember the days where we used to carry those change, $10 bills and $5 and awkwardly getting out of the window to pay that, to reach that machine? It's still happening at many places, but still Singapore is a bit ahead in that. And but now, with the connected world devices, it can happen automatically again, right? Like, I go inside the parking, I come out of the parking, you just tell me that it happened. You don't want to make payments without knowing that it happened, right? So, yeah. We are in the era of invisible design. It is not scary, looking at the emoji there, but it is happening around us in every sphere of life, and we need to be ready for it. And as a designer, we need to design for it. It is happening at home, where our entertainment devices are connected. We listen to Spotify, it starts playing what we want, which is amazing, right? It's happening in our car, it tells you the best route possible to your workplace. It is making payment without you making effort. It schedules your maintenance of the car without making an effort. It's happening in our leisure time. When I see social media these days, it creeps me out sometimes because it's recommending me my next destination so well, and I'm so tempted to go to that new place all the time. It knows my pattern, it knows who I am, and it recommends me something which I really want to do. Our bodies, Fitbit scale. I stand on that Fitbit scale every day in the morning, but I'm just taking one action, but everything else around it is happening automatically. It's telling me what exercise should I do today, it's telling me what diet should I take, it's actually maintaining my body. Shopping, again, it's telling you the best deals, the recommendations. Cities, which gets more interesting, right? Our cities are, the experience in cities got also getting invisible. My train timings are getting automatically altered based on the traffic we have. Your red lights are getting more and more smart depending on the traffic condition on the road. It's just managing things seamlessly without me even knowing it. I think this thing translates into a big design principle for all of us. And something which I, as a person, I want to do naturally. The experiences should get invisible. Or the way of actually experiencing the experience should get invisible. And it's a big design principle which we look at when we work on different projects and even on in my personal life. How can we make things simple and we don't even notice it? It just gets natural to us. And why is it possible now? What is enabling this invisibility? The reason one, hardware is changing. We have so many hardwares around us. Remember the days, 90s, when we just used to have that personal computer, and now we have smartphones, iPads, I don't know, God knows how many devices. And we have seen the best transformation ever in this world, right? Like we have seen the transformation of hardware happening now. We have heard about the Moore's Law, right? And he talked about it, saying that every 2 years, the processing speed is gonna get double. It's not just the processing speed. Even if the size of hardware is getting smaller, it's getting cheaper. And it's getting interesting for the world of IoT now because we see more and more devices around us, which is helping us connect different experiences and making it more invisible. And this is how the hardware plays for me at payment industry. We started with barter in 9000 BC. But the economic conditions changed that system. We then came up with the invention of tokens, which was in the form of coins. But it had its own limitation because it was bulky, it was difficult to carry around. And then we thought, okay, let's make it more easier to carry around, so we changed it to paper notes. But again, paper notes still had the same issue because it's not secure to store so much paper notes. Then we went into the time where we started pulling in the money into an account and represented that account using a physical plastic. We still are in that phase. All of you, I'm sure, have physical plastic in your wallet. But it is evolving further. Why do I really need to carry my wallet? Why can't it be just in the mobile? We are already seeing that shift in many parts of the world, and it doesn't end here. It's going to evolve further and further. Yeah, like Bitcoin and other things which are coming now. So there's no end to it. Let me give you an example. One of the things which we worked on was, how can we have a best gaming experiences at Olympics without thinking about payment. So you don't really need to carry a wallet, but I'm there to view the games. I just want to buy my food and beverage and tickets seamlessly. So how can we embed that payment into other accessories which you're going to use during the games? Like, for example, because Winter Olympics, having those winter gloves connected to payment terminals, having those pins, souvenir pins and stickers enabled with payment, and it just makes it easier for people to just go around the Olympics village and make payments. So it's the hardware which is enabling that payment experience, which is natural to people. Like, I just walk and make the payment. Communication. That's a very interesting thing for me, because these days we see that it's a madness of notifications, right? Do we still need that madness? All right. There can be other ways of communicating it. There can be another softer ways of communicating what you want to communicate to the user. And one of the examples here is proof of payment. So we were studying this in Australia some time back, which is a very tap-to-pay heavy market where people are very used. It's very natural to them. They just take out the card and tap on a terminal. Whenever you ask them how you make a payment, I just tap down to the terminal. I was like, okay. It's so natural. And we don't think about it. I think Singapore is getting there, but many other markets, they don't think about it. They still think about cash, or they're still about thinking about swiping. Swiping is a thing. I just swipe the card. Over there, it's more about tapping the card. So I asked them, how do you know the payment has actually happened? They said, there's this tick mark which comes onto the terminal, and there's that sound which comes, and sometimes it goes beep, 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 that I know that it's not happened. So they're not looking at the screen, the payment is happening or not. They're just looking at that feedback of payment. Building onto that principle, we worked onto the sensory payment experience, which is threefold. One is that little tick animation, and the second is the haptic feedback of vibration, and the third is that sound. I hope it plays. So there's a sound which we worked on, which took us a year to actually develop. But there was a lot of testing done on it in terms of physical reaction to the sounds, neural research onto that, how people are reacting to that sound. So you will see that sound coming up again and again at many places, and it will become like a brand mark of the proof of payment. Third reason. Because of all these things, human behavior is changing. The experiences are becoming more natural to us. The example I gave, right, the Uber ride. There are many other things which are happening. Let me give you an example of a wallet. We are thinking, we are still carrying those wallets, right? Maybe the size is getting smaller. In some countries, it's still big. Like if you go to Japan, people are still carrying those big, massive wallets. You come here, people have shifted to those card holders. But if you go to China, one out of three users is actually using Alipay Chat to make the payment. We are getting there. How many of you use mobile payments these days and not use a piece of plastic? Yeah. So it is shifting, right? Your wallet is going to behave, become a phone for you. You don't need a wallet anymore. So that's a behavioral change which is happening in the payment world, but it's visible in many other spheres, right? It's not just the payment. We need to design for such world, and how can we design for it? I think it's a big question, right? I'm not going to get into a lot of detail of it, but I'm going to give a framework which we can work upon. So these are the four things which comprises of a good service design model when you're designing for invisibility. First is the North Star, defining that North Star, having the guiding principles around that North Star, and identifying those micro moments, and creating a blueprint. I'm going to talk a bit more about it, how it's going to play out further. Have a North Star. I think finding that right problem which you're trying to solve, I think one of the panelists also talking about it, finding that right problem which you want to solve is super critical. And we need to understand what will make, if we solve this problem, what will happen to that user? Is it really going to make their life better and simpler? defining that North Star is super critical, and that's the reason why your service or your product or anything you're doing actually exists. There are two components to it. One is having a statement and having an evolution statement. So the vision statement is basically defining if you design the service, what's going to happen to them, and what are you trying to solve for them. It acts like a good framework and acts like a good brief for all the people who are working on that project. And vision evolution is super critical, I feel, because this is what will keep you grounded, because you will know if you design for this particular problem, what will your product is going to do to them. It's like a future state statement for you. Is it going to really work, and how people are actually going to experience it with your new service? Principles. These design principles are super important, right? We need to define a boundary around whatever we are designing. There can be three components to it. It can evolve further, but I think these are three things which we really think are super critical when we're defining the principle. What are we trying to capture? And what are we trying to learn? And what are we trying to decide for the user? If we know these three things in a blueprint, it will help us think further. It will help us create that interplay of different components into this, in the service blueprint. Identifying those moments, the key moments that matter, are super important. We all know that. But knowing those micro moments in that moment is super critical, because if you know that micro moment, that's where you're gonna make the service, the experience, invisible. This is a Google framework of micro moments, which I find really, really helpful. These are the three different strategies to define any micro moment. The first is the anticipation of being there. You are there before the user actually expects you to be there. The second is contextual. You know the context of the user, and that's how you're enabling your service. And as the name suggests, micro moment, it needs to be fast and frictionless. So if these three things are there in your micro moment, when you're enabling those micro moment, it really creates that natural experience for the user. And when we think about those micro moments, it's really important what's triggering them. So every action is a reaction. Whatever we're doing, we're reacting to something. If I'm sending payment to someone using chat, it's because someone has asked for it. And how can we anticipate that behavior and create a reaction to it? And to summarize all of this into a service blueprint is something which will help you to deliver really a good experience. And I think we have been doing this a lot, and it really helps anyone and everyone who's working on that service to know what it's going to look like and how it's going to play out. It's an evolving thing. Every time there is a different trigger, you will have a new service playing out for that trigger. So to combine all of it, have a North Star. Really define that North Star and be in sync with the whole business, that's what you're working towards. Put it on your wall. Establish principles. Identify what micro moments you're trying to solve for in that particular service. And create a blueprint. It's like an architecture blueprint. I'm just going to say it's not the end. It's just the beginning. We are starting to get into an invisible world. And as a UX designer and other designers, it's our role to make sure that we are not giving extra effort to the user, and we are trying to make it more pervasive for them, and which becomes more natural, and we are changing the behavior for it. It's really important we think about it, because evolution is happening faster than ever, and we really need to start thinking about it. And I really like this quote from Superman. Spider-Man comics. With this kind of invisibility, obviously we don't want to make it overwhelming, but as a designer who have a lot of power comes a great responsibility. So we need to always make sure that we are in our limits of ethics and privacy, and not creeping out people with your new invisible experiences. To end with, we are in the era of invisible design and we need to start thinking about it. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mitushi. We're just going to hook up our Slido so that we can have more questions. Well, while we're doing our Slido, I have one burning question. Sure. What happened to that cab driver?
I paid for it.
Okay.
I tried Comfort Delgro, reported it, and then it was a very different report.
All right. It's great to build things that become habitual and invisible, but can it also be determinable? Example, healthy friction in our products can prevent mistakes.
Yes, I think we need to define what type of habits we want to create. Sometimes friction is important. For example, when I was saying that proof of payment is important, like in the connected car, you don't want to just make the payment and get away with it. You really want to give that feedback to the user that the payment has happened, because I don't want to see my credit card statement at the end of the month and realize that so many payments happened but I didn't know about it. So yeah, you have to sometimes design for that friction as well, but yeah, we need to be careful what we're designing for.
Next question. Do you have experiences using Alipay or WeChat? What do you think? How Visa can stand out from those competitors and win more sticky users by design?
Yes, we have been doing more experiments and learning how the behavior is changing, especially in China. It's a very interesting world, and there's something to learn from. So yeah, we're learning from it. And especially for Visa, I think we have to evolve and design for it.
So aside from payments, where else can we apply invisible design?
Everywhere. The example I gave, right, it can be in our home, like how Amazon is doing, right? They are not thinking about just shopping on Amazon.com or whatever the URL is. They are also thinking about how can those micro moments which lead to you to shop on Amazon can be developed further, like having that dash button, which helps you create a list automatically on your refrigerator, for example. So yeah, defining those moments, it's everywhere, I would say. Yeah.
We're just going to take our last question for the day. Yeah. Who defines what's ethical in invisible design, especially when our decisions are being ruled by algorithms?
Well, yeah, it's a world of AI, and yeah, we need to be careful when we're designing for it. We don't want to automate too much. And again, stressing on the point that we need to be in our limits of ethics and just think as a human, what's ethical and what's not, and keep in mind when you're designing.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Mitushi, for coming over and sharing your experiences with us.
Thank you.
Big round.
Thank you.